The information and opinions expressed by our guests are not necessarily endorsed by this radio show, nor the radio show hosts. The intent of this radio program is to provide information. We encourage the listener to do their own research and connect their own dots. Hi, this is Ari Kopel with Shattering the Matrix. We have our very distinguished guest today, Augusto Perez. Augusto has been preaching the gospel since 1982. He founded a church in the city of Miami, Florida, my hometown, where he was the pastor for 7 years. For about 3 years, he had a daily radio program that was heard by more than 20,000 people. Augusto's only desire is to glorify and manifest Jesus Christ to the world. In recent years, Augusto has done over 150 radio shows and interviews on different radio and block talk radio. He has written 4 books titled Smile, Jesus Loves You, Open Heavens, Introductions to Signs and Wonders, as well as Foundational Principles for New Converts and Believers. This year, he did his first DVD with the Prophecy Club entitled The End of Times. Augusto, welcome to Shattering the Matrix.
Good to be on your show, Ari.
Thank you very much for taking the time to be with us today. We have a lot to cover, Augusto, and I'm going to explain to our listeners the reason that I personally decided to have you on this show. Our listeners, Augusto, as you know, I was speaking to you behind the scenes here, are varied in terms of their spirituality and their understandings and their attainment and things like that. And it's very interesting, though, that there are so many people nowadays, it's just too numerous to leave it to coincidence, that are having visions of certain events coming down the pike very soon. And when I was made aware of you, all these little lights and whistles, you know, went off, because I'm saying, oh my gosh, this man, not only is he a man of God, he's getting visions, and they're very similar to visions I have had and visions that I know other people have had that are not even, maybe they are not even of the Christian faith, yet they're having them as well. So I wanted to explore that with you so that you can give, in, you know, put into perspective the times that we're in, and what is coming down the pike that people need to be paying attention to. So with that in mind, I wanted to ask you, if you don't mind sharing. I was under the impression that you are a Christian man, of course, but that you may also know of New Age principles or New Age concepts. Is that correct, or am I incorrect with that?
Yeah, you're correct. You're very correct. I share a lot of that in my book, Smile, Jesus Loves You, which is my autobiography, which it takes you all the way from when I was in Cuba all the way to the present. And I saw the revolution in Cuba. I saw Castro coming to Cuba. I was only in my early teens. Actually, when I left Cuba, I was 12 still. So I was even preteen, and when I saw all this happen, and throughout my pilgrimage, okay, I've always been looking for God. Even since I was a little boy, I always felt that God was near. Although I didn't know how to express it, I didn't know how to articulate it, but I always felt He was there with me. He was like a friend, and I always felt His presence. And it was kind of hard for me to explain it to others who, you know, had no clue what I was talking about. The Lord always seemed to give me premonitions of things. For example, even when I was in Cuba, when Castro came in, in the revolution from the Sierra Maestra, from Oriente, everybody was celebrating, and everybody was, causing a big thing about it. And inside of me, I knew this thing was not going to turn out well. I just knew it. And I could have made a couple of comments about it to my parents, but, you know, parents dismissed me, as most parents do when their children come to them with visions and dreams about spiritual things. They usually think, you know, that they just had a pizza or went to bed, you know, maybe an indigestion or something like that.
Yeah.
But to make a long story short, through my years, after I came to the U.S. and I became an engineer. I worked as an engineer for 10 years, civil engineer. We designed, I was involved in the design of the, for those living in Miami, for the pipeline that brought water from Florida City to the Keys. In many other projects, I was involved in the downtown project that was built right there in the, near the water. A real tall building. Many of those projects I was involved in the design and so forth, so that people know a little bit about my background as well. But I was looking. I was looking for God. I went to all churches I could go to. You name it, I was there. Every and all denominations, from Catholic to Baptist, Pentecostal, Presbyterian, Lutheran, Episcopal, you name it. I was there. Even Jehovah's Witness tried to preach to me, and I listened. I listened to everybody, but they all fell short of what I was looking for. I was looking for God, and everything I ever found was man and religion.
Yeah.
And so eventually I had a talk with a priest, the parochial priest, mm-hmm. where I lived, who was a good man. He may still be alive. He's a good man. And he was one of the few priests that I could sit down and talk about, you know, things like this and ask him questions, and he would listen. Most of them wouldn't even give me the time to listen to me. And but this one did, and I appreciate that. And but anyways, when I told him what I was looking for, and I was looking for the Spirit of God, I had heard about the Holy Spirit, and I had heard about some of the charismatic movement in the Catholic Church. And so I was inquiring him about it, you know, and I will never forget the words he said to me. He said, don't worry about that. He says, that's not for you. He said, those people are kind of lunatics out there, you know, wanting an experience, wanting the, you know, all these extravagant experiences and feelings and things. He says, you don't need that. Just you go to Mass and just read the Bible, come to Mass, and that's it. You know, do confessions when you need to. And I will never forget when he said that, something in my spirit just like dropped. And I had lost all hope then.
Yeah.
So after that event, I stopped going to all the churches. I really never went back to church, Catholic or any other church. I said, what's the use?
Right.
I keep sinning, and I keep going to confession, and forgiveness. The priest forgives and absolves me, and go. And then I go over. I said, this is not what I'm looking for. This is for the birds, you know. I said, this cannot be God.
Right.
And there's got to be more to this. And so I never went back. Never went back. And I began my search on my own. I got involved in drugs. I never did the hard stuff, you know. I never did the heroin or things like that. I just, you know, took cocaine and grass and things like that. I drank a lot of booze.
Mm-hmm.
I began to read occultic books like Carlos Castaneda.
Mm-hmm.
I read all the books of Carlos Castaneda. I read the books of Peter Damian Ouspensky. I read the book of Gurdjieff.
Mm-hmm.
I was really looking, and a lot of what these people were sharing, although it kind of never sat well in my spirit, at least it had some semblance of spirituality, some semblance of the deeper things of the spirit, which I was hungering for. I was hungry. I was starving for the presence of God and the spiritual things of God. And so, which is normally what happens, Ari, whenever the churches, okay, do not give the people the presence of God,
mm-hmm.
whenever they do not allow the people the presence of God and the power of the Holy Spirit and the things, the deeper things of God, whenever that is withheld from the people are going to begin to gravitate towards occult and occultic things.
Mm-hmm.
And the occult and demon spirits and fallen angelic things, activity, and all this other supernatural things like vampirism and you know, things like zombieism and all these things begin begin to fill the void that was supposed to have been taken up by God and the power of His Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
So this is especially true of young people. Young people, I was young back then. I may not be young right now, but I was very young back then. I was in my 20s. And I was searching. I had all the money I could want. I had a lot of money. I was, I had the time. I had the ability to go anywhere I wanted, anywhere in the world, travel. I could have any girl I wanted. I was a bachelor. I had my own bachelor pad. I was living it up. Every weekend I went out drinking with my buddies, and we had parties. I mean, that was the lifestyle I was in, and I was looking, really. I was searching is what I was doing, which is probably what most people out there doing the same things today are doing.
Right.
They're searching.
Yep.
They're searching for identity. They're searching for who they are, where they come from, and where they're going. What is, who really are they?
Right.
There's a search for identity. And the only way anyone can find themselves and who they are is by knowing God, by knowing the Lord. Until people know the Lord, they will never know who they are. That is the sad reality, and that is the sad truth. But it is the truth, nevertheless. Until you find Him, or He finds you, you will never know who you are, and you will never find yourself. Because inside of each one of you, there is a desire, there is a hunger to know the living God, whether you realize that or not. And everything that you're involved right now, whatever it is, whether it be drugs, alcohol, sex, the occult, whatever it is a search for the Father, a search for your loving Father who created you, made you, and has a plan for your life and a destiny for you. So your part is to find out, to find Him, or ask Him to find you. And if you ask Him, He will come to you. He will find you. But you have to open the door. You have to open that door and say, come in, Lord, I need you, please. And that's what it took me. That's what it took me. It took me to get to that point where I was just plain tired.
Yeah.
Okay? Of having relationships that failed, of going after self-satisfying things, sexual relationships, drugs, alcohol, partying, having a great time. Even all those things became empty to me.
Oh, absolutely.
And I realized, one day I realized that, and I felt so empty. I felt empty.
Hmm.
And here I was. I was healthy. I was young. I had money. I had a car. I had the ability to do and go anywhere I wanted, and yet I was empty. And a lot of people may never get to that point because they are different. But I see, like I said from the beginning, God had a plan for my life. I believe there are certain people out there. The Bible calls them predestined, which means that the Lord knows you since you were even born. He knows you. He knows He created you. He knows the future. He knows everything about you. And He knows that there's a tenderness in your heart for Him. There is a soft spot in your heart for Him. And so you will never be happy, never, until you find Him, until He comes into your life. And so I came to that point where I basically, one weekend, I just, I told my friend, I said, listen, his name is Sergio. I said, Sergio, don't come get me this weekend, because I'm not going out. I'm staying. I'm staying home. I'm not going partying and drinking and boozing. I'm staying home. So don't bother coming. Come by for me because I won't go anywhere. So I told him that. That was a Friday, and that night I just had a talk with God. I didn't know how to pray. I didn't know how to read the Bible. I had a big old Catholic Bible with images. weighed like a ton. I had it mostly for just show because it was so pretty, it was so beautiful. And I had it sitting on the table, and I never really opened it. I never read it. And, that night I just talked to God. I said, God, if you're real, help me. help me. I am tired of this. I need you. I want you. Please help me. And that's all I said. And I went to bed that night, and about 1 in the morning or so, I hear a knock on the door, you know, and then I hear someone calling my name, Augusto. Well, I thought it was Sergio coming to get me, and I mean, I could have sworn that that was him, you know, knocking on the door and calling. So I get up, turn the light on, throw some clothes on, and I go to the door, and when I open the door, I said, Sergio, I started saying, Sergio, I thought I told you not to come by this week, blah, 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 and there was nobody there. So I looked left and right, and there was nobody there. Mm. I closed the door, and I thought to myself, man, I must be going crazy here.
Right.
So I went back to bed, and I sat on my bed. I said, God, was that you? Was that you that knocked on the door and called my name three times or twice and knocked on the door three times and called my name twice? I said, was that you? And no answer. Silent. And I said, okay. I took a big old Bible. I put it on my lap. And I said, okay, here's this Bible. This is your word. I said, I'm going to open it, and please, let me read what you want to say to me. Let me open to the page and my eyes fall on what you want to say to me. And when I opened the big old Bible, I opened to John. No, I'm sorry. I opened to Revelation. I think it's chapter 3 where it says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If you open, I will come in and sup with you.
Oh, my God.
And I, when I saw that, that's exactly what I said. I said, oh, my God. I closed the Bible now. And I said, I can't believe this. But then, you know, then I started reasoning. I said, well, this is just a coincidence. So I said, yeah, probably it was just a coincidence. Said, okay. Let's start again. God, please, you know. I'm going to do this again. You know, maybe this was a coincidence. Yeah. If this was really you, mm-hmm. please, do it again. Mm-hmm. Speak to me again. Open the Bible again and let me read. And so I opened the Bible again, and I opened the page to the Gospel of John, chapter 3, where Jesus tells Nicodemus, Nicodemus, verily, verily, I say unto you, you must be born again of the water and the Spirit. If you're not born again of the water and the Spirit, you cannot see the kingdom of God, and you cannot enter the kingdom of God. I closed that scripture, that Bible again. I said, I couldn't believe it. I said, no, this is not happening.
Mm-hmm.
And then I said, okay, here I go again. And then I said, God,
oh my God,
please don't be upset at me. Please don't get upset at me. Please, but could you do this one third time? I'm not going to ask you more. I'm not going to ask you again. Do it one last time, because I just need to be sure, please. Well, sure enough, I opened the Bible. The third time I opened the scripture, says, behold, I come quickly. And I say, okay, well, this is undeniable now that mm-hmm. God is talking to me. Mm-hmm. And it was him who knocked on the door, and it was him who called my name. Okay? And, you know, I'm a pretty stubborn person, Ari, and, you know, it takes me, you know, I don't just go for stuff easy, but once I go for something, mm-hmm. and I know it is the real deal, I'll just hold on to it, and I am not going to let it go.
Yeah.
And, you know, I hold on to it like a bulldog, and so mm-hmm. I knew this was from God. There was no denying it. There was no arguing it. And he had proven to me beyond the shadow of a doubt that he had talked to me that night. And I said to him, I said, you're telling me you knocked on my door and you called my name. You said, if I will open the door, you come in. And then you tell me that I need to be born again of the water and the Spirit. If not, I cannot enter the kingdom of God. And then you're telling me that you're coming soon. I said, God, you're telling me to get saved, to get born again because you're coming soon. Is that what you're telling me? Again, no answer.
Oh, boy.
Well, a short time after that, you know, I kept living my life, and, you know, but that stayed in my heart.
Mm-hmm.
And so a short time after that, I have a dream. And this particular dream, I was in this room. It was white, a white room, and there were many people there dressed in white robes. And there was one person laying on a bed. The person was lying on a bed. It was like one of those like surgical beds in the hospitals, you know.
Right.
This was that type of bed, yeah. And people were there, and like there were a couple of those men there that were doing some kind of surgery on the heart. And I thought, you know, what I was seeing was like an open heart surgery. Really, that's what I thought at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And there were all the people there around these two men, you know, which I now know they were angels, and they were watching, you know, they were watching and just waiting anxiously and you know, with a lot of expectation. And so suddenly, as I was watching this scene play out before me, and I was in this room, okay? Whether I was there in the spirit or it was a vision, I don't know, but I was there.
Yeah.
And one of these men turned and looked at me. And with his hand, he makes a motion to me to get closer, to come closer. Well, when I see that, I just told him, no. And I turned around and walked away, and I woke up.
Hmm.
Well, that was not the end of that.
I'm sure it wasn't.
A short time after that, a few days after that, I have the same dream again. Same dream, same place, same thing going on. But this time, one of the men that was there, he comes up to me. Okay, he doesn't talk to me, he just comes up to me, takes me by my arm, and leads me through this door, like a doorway that I saw. And when we get to the doorway, he gently just, you know, we walk through it. We walk through the doorway, he pushes me through the door, we walk through the doorway, and when I go through the doorway, I am in another world. I'm in another place, which was the most beautiful place I've ever seen, ever.
Hmm.
I mean, it was otherworldly. It's the only thing I can think, the only way to describe it.
Mm-hmm.
And this experience I made out into a music CD, which is in one of my three CDs. You know, I made three CDs for young people. The Lord had me do this starting in the year 2000. And they're kind of, I call it prophetic rap. But it has a lot of prophetic music in it, a lot of prophetic lyrics in it.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the songs, and this one is in a CD called Tuning Into Reality. And it's called A Visit to Heaven. And I share this whole testimony there in the form of music. And anyway, when I go through the door,
mm-hmm.
Everything was so beautiful. The grass was so green. It's the greenest green I've ever seen,
mm-hmm.
And it was like transparent green. It was like almost like shining green.
It was like luminescent. Life. Was it like luminescent?
Luminescent,
yes.
Green.
Mm-hmm.
Almost transparent. And the sky, the blue of the sky was so beautiful. It was gorgeous.
Mm-hmm.
It was a deep blue that was beyond description. The trees, I mean, everything was alive.
Yes.
And the leaves of the trees were alive.
Mm-hmm.
And the grass was alive.
Mm-hmm.
The sounds I heard were, it was like a big synth. cacophony, all merging together and just producing the most beautiful atmosphere and music
right.
that I have ever heard in my entire life.
Yep.
And because it was not just music, it was like everything just flowed together.
Yes.
In harmony.
Yes.
In harmony with it, with each other, and in harmony with me. I was in harmony with it.
Exactly.
I felt a part of it.
Yep.
I felt like I was a part of it, and it was a part of me. It was a very strange. I can't even describe it, but I started walking because I was so amazed, so absorbed by all of this I was seeing. And I was looking around. I was just amazed. And I see a tree, a big, huge tree in the distance there. And the tree was so beautiful and so appealing. And it had a scroll in one of the branches. And the moment I saw that, I knew I was supposed to take it. I knew that was for me. I knew that was there for me.
Right.
Because one of the things, when you're in the spirit realm, you know things even though no one tells you anything.
That's right.
Even though you don't hear it mm-hmm. in words or anything, you just know.
Mm-hmm.
You just know things supernaturally, okay? It's like you get downloads.
That's right.
Like a computer.
Yep.
You get downloads. When you're in the spirit realm, you get downloads. And you just know stuff. You just know it.
Mm-hmm.
And you get a download, and you know a bunch of stuff, okay, like instantly, without hearing it or nobody telling you anything about it. So that's how that was. And I knew that was supposed to be for me. I was supposed to take it. So when I saw it, I started walking towards it. And when I got to it, I reached, and I took the scroll from one of the branches, you know, and he was shining. He was just, he was incredible. But, you know, I kept looking, and everything around me, I kept seeing new things. I kept seeing new places. I saw a big old bright light in the distance I wanted to get to. And, you know, I kept walking towards it. I mean, and I did not read the scroll. I did not open it. And so as I began my pilgrimage, you know, towards that place, I felt the hand reach into, you know, and grab my arm
mm-hmm.
and then pull me out of that place, back through the door where I came through. Mm-hmm. And I, back to, you know, that room where I was in. And when that happens, I was upset. And I tell this man, the angel, I said, why did you do that? Why did you take me out of there? I didn't want to leave. Why did you take me out? And he just looked at me and reached and took the scroll from my hand that I had not opened yet. And he looked at me and said, you have not even opened the scroll. He said, you are not ready.
Oh boy.
To continue the stroll. And I woke up right there.
Wow.
Well, that was like you say nowadays, that just blew me away.
Oh, sure.
And mm-hmm. I didn't know what that was about. I didn't share that with anyone. I mean, why bother? No one would believe me anyway. So I just talked it away, you know, in my heart and for, you know, for the future, because I didn't know what that meant. I said, what was that all about? You see, people need to understand, and many people listening to me out there may be where I was, and maybe others are not. Maybe others know what all that means, but I didn't know what it meant. I didn't know what that was all about, you see?
Mm-hmm.
No one had ever taught me the Bible. No one had ever taught me what these things mean. No one had ever taught me about the Book of Life. No one had ever taught me about the Tree of Life. No one had ever taught me about that Jesus is the door. No man can go to the Father except through me. I am the door that leads to eternal life. And you know, no one had ever told me about a heart that when we come to the Lord, He would give you a new heart. and he would, if you will, he would perform surgery in your heart and remove your hardened heart and would give you a soft, tender heart, that he would write his laws into your heart. No one ever taught me about any of this. I didn't know what any of this meant. So, you know, I was totally in ignorance. I didn't know. I didn't know how to pray. I didn't know about heaven. Or I knew about heaven, but no one had ever explained to me what heaven was or how things would be in heaven or anything like that. And so I was basically, stunned. I was astonished. I didn't know what to do with that, and so I just shut my mouth and kept on living. While that was going on, I met who is now my wife. I met her in a nightclub. A nightclub in Miami, which I used to attend with my friend Sergio and others, called the Alley Cat.
Ah, my gosh, I probably ran into you there.
Yeah, well, that's where I used to go a lot of time.
Me too. How hilarious. Interesting.
One day if I say this, maybe some people won't believe me, but do you know who I saw there one time?
Who?
Mickey Mantle.
No kidding.
Mickey Mantle was there sitting at the bar.
Oh, my gosh. I used to love that place. Loved it. It was right around the corner.
Go in there and say hi to Mick, That was before he passed away. For those that don't know, Mickey Mantle was a center fielder, famous center fielder for the New York Yankees. Mm-hmm. But he was an alcoholic. And he died in that condition. I felt so sorry. But I wasn't saved. I didn't know the Lord back then, so I couldn't help him.
Mm-hmm.
But I saw him there. He was sitting there drinking. And that night is where I met my wife, who is now my wife. And I remember I went up to her and I said, I was just trying, to dance and have fun. I just went up to her and said, do you want to dance? She said, no. I said, okay.
Right. Yeah.
Strike one. I said, okay, do you want a drink? She said, no. I said, strike two.
Right.
And I said, okay, well, can I sit down here and just talk to you for a few minutes? And so she said, yeah, you can do that. I said, okay. So I talked to her for a little while, and when I started talking to her, I realized that she had been to church, and she had just had an experience with Jesus Christ.
Wow.
The Sunday before. And so she was still, in that state where, she had that first impact. She wasn't fully converted yet, but she was, she had that encounter. So she wasn't really doing any much. She wasn't drinking. She wasn't dancing. And I guess she just went there, out of habit. And I understand that now, but I didn't understand that back then.
Yeah.
And so anyways, make a long story short, we started going out. And the more we went out, the more I realized, that this wasn't for me. She was, in a state that I just didn't know anything about. And, she wouldn't really, all she wanted to do was talk about Jesus Christ and those things. And,
mm-hmm.
and so I was so fed up with religion. People need to understand to me back then I was fed up with religion. So when I had an encounter in the spirit with the Lord, that was real.
Mm-hmm.
I understood that. That was real. But when somebody started talking to me about religion and the church and stuff, that just turned me off right off the bat. I mean,
right.
It was like somebody took a, just pulled the switch off. I mean, just turned me off. I mean, and that, because I had gone through so much.
Yep, yep. And that's where a lot of our listeners are right now, too, just so you know.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah. And I completely identify with that because
yeah.
I was there.
Mm-hmm.
So when she started talking to me about Jesus Christ, and the church and this and that, I mean, that just turned me off so bad that eventually I just told her, listen, you just keep going to church. And, I know you love God. I know you love Jesus Christ. Just keep going there. And, because that's not where I'm heading.
Mm-hmm.
You are going in one direction. I'm going in another. And, I think we just say goodbye and, just go live your life and I go live mine. And that was what I did, and then we stopped going out and we stopped seeing each other for a long time, maybe for about a year or so.
Oh, wow.
Or close to a year. And So after that time, you know, one day I get a call. I was in my engineering office. I got a call from her, and basically, you know, just wanted to say hi. And so I said, yeah, fine, you know. Do you mind if I call you? I said, no, that's all right, you know. So I went out. We went out again, and this time it was different. She was wiser about these things, and she didn't talk as much about it. You know, she just was very spiritual about it and sensitive, and didn't try to shove it down my throat. And
right.
You know, and just you know, was nice to me and stuff. You know, so I started going out with her again, and eventually she invited me to go to church, and you know, at that time I said, yeah, sure, why not? You know, and it's not going to kill me. So I went there. And when I went to this church, it was a spirit-filled church, Pentecostal church, and the people started worshiping God and raising their hands up and all that stuff, and I didn't like that one bit. I didn't like that one bit. I said, what are all these nuts doing here? Everybody's screaming and raising their hands and all this stuff. Mm-hmm. And then through the middle of that, I felt like a presence wanted to come inside of me. I felt like something like that, and I didn't like that. Mm-hmm. I felt like, no. See, I was the self-preservation took
mm-hmm.
over,
mm-hmm.
and so I just left. We left, and I didn't go back there for a while. So eventually, you know, I guess she got a little more seasoned in this, and she got counsel by like some of the elders, and they offered me a Bible study. And so I said, what do you mean Bible study? And then you say, yeah, we are, you know. And it was this guy, his name was Art Schnitzer, I never forget it. And he was a very, very nice man, a good guy. He was a just servant of the Lord. You know, he was willing to drive as long and as far as he needed to in order to teach anybody a Bible study and bring them to Jesus Christ. So he told me, listen, I'll go to your home. You don't have to go anywhere. I'll go right to where you live, and I will give you a Bible study right in your house once a week for about an hour. He said, can you spare 1 hour? That's all. And we'll study the Bible. You can ask any questions you want. Well, you know, even for someone like me, that was an offer that I couldn't turn down. I mean, I had a lot of questions.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of questions in my heart that I needed to ask somebody. And everybody I had asked the questions to, nobody wanted to answer them. And they just, you know, pushed me away and turned me off. So this offer, I said, when he offered it, I said, sure, why not? I mean, it's just an hour a week, and, you know, I got nothing to lose. 1 hour a week, and I sure have a lot of questions. So he started coming to my bachelor's pad, and he almost freaked out when he saw my bachelor's pad, because I had, all kinds. I had swords there. I had the head of David there on one side. I had all kinds of weird stuff, you know, and and I had skins in the wall and carpets. I mean, it was kind of freaky. It was the bachelor's pad.
Mm-hmm.
And so when he first went in there, he almost freaked out. He said, whoa. And anyways, he said, wow. So he came in, and we sat down in the bachelor's pad. And one thing, though, that place was really quiet, and you could really sit down there and have a spiritual conversation without anybody bothering you.
Mm-hmm.
There was no noise and nothing, so it was ideal for that, and the Lord knew it. And so he started giving me Bible studies once a week. Every Tuesday, he would come. And for 1 hour, we sat there and we began in Genesis. And he just kept going through. And every time I had a question, I stopped him. And he was very kind about it. And he answered it. And I really was enjoying it. I started looking forward to every Tuesday whenever he would come. I really started looking every week. I started looking to that day when he would come, because for some reason I was enjoying finding out things that I never knew, I never understood, and finally having someone explain them to me in the Bible, explained unto me in the Bible, not by things he said, but by the Bible, by things written in the Word of God. So I really was enjoying that. And for the first time in my life, I began to really enjoy reading the Bible because I began to understand it.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people don't want to read the Bible, Ari, because they do not understand it. They frustrate them. It confuses them. And they end up saying, no, I ain't going to bother with this. This doesn't make sense at all. It just doesn't make any sense. And it is true. If you don't understand the Bible, if no one has ever taught you and you don't know certain things, the Bible won't make any sense to you. It may even contradict itself if you do not understand it. So it takes someone helping you, explaining things to you, so that you begin to understand the concepts and the principles and some of the things that are written in the Bible, why and, you know, when and so forth. So when these things begin to be explained, then it makes sense. And then you finally understand the Bible.
Yeah.
And the Bible does not contradict itself. It is one of the most powerful books I've ever... It is the most powerful book I've ever read.
Hmm.
Forget about all the books of Ouspensky and Gurdjieff and all those things. Even though there was some wisdom there and there was maybe some light there, a little bit of light. When I started understanding this thing, it was like a floodlight. I mean, just like the sun. You open the door and the sun shone in your face. I mean, it was a blast of light, a blast of revelation,
oh, sure.
A blast of understanding.
Mm-hmm.
Because within the pages of the Bible, it is all the wisdom of God. It is enclosed in there.
Hmm.
It doesn't contain. It is the wisdom of God. It is God.
So
it is the Word of God. It is the living Word. So that's what I was experiencing. So I started looking forward, mm-hmm, to having this guy come in every Tuesday. And whenever he couldn't come, I really felt bad.
Yeah.
and that was me, you know, back then.
Yeah. So at some point, though, Augusto, you did something. I mean, we're going to see how we can incorporate all the things that obviously you went from not being a believer to now, you know, being curious and now, you know, getting the training or the information about the Bible. At what point now are you at now where you're actually being communicated via visions about what is going to be transpiring very soon? And can you go into that as well?
Sure. Okay, let me just wrap up.
Sure.
That part, and then I'll get into that part that
Fantastic.
You asked me. Anyway, after a while, he started getting into the New Testament and sharing Jesus with me, okay?
Okay.
People need to understand that Jesus Christ is not a historical character. He's real. He is the Almighty God manifested in the flesh. And when he started sharing who Jesus was, that he was God manifested in flesh, the Son of the living God, and that he died for me, and he did all this for me. And although I had heard this many times before, it never made any sense to me until now. Then he began to explain to me all the miracles that Jesus did, how he healed the sick, how he cleansed the lepers, how he raised the dead. I never knew this. I never knew this, you know. And then he said, all these things are available to us today. And then we went into the book of Acts. And then we went into the part where, you know, where in the Acts chapter 2, where the disciples received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And they were all baptized with the Holy Spirit and spoke in tongues. And then he told me, he said, this is for everyone. This is for you today. This is for me. This is for our sons. This is for our daughters. This is for everyone. And he showed it to me in Scripture. It's written right there. Not just for a few. This is for everyone. This is not just for preachers. This is not for priests. This is for everybody. Every little boy and girl, everybody out there that is hungry and thirsty and seeking, is for them. It's for you. So when this became a reality in my heart, I told him, I said, I want this. I want this. This is what I've been looking for all my life. So he told me, he said, said, well, let's get you baptized in water, you know. And I had been baptized as a little boy. But I knew I had to be rebaptized because a little baby doesn't know what he's doing. Because Jesus says, repent and be baptized. So I had to be baptized. I have to be. Okay. So he said, he talked to the pastor. The pastor said, okay, come next Sunday or next Wednesday and we'll have it ready, because he had just come back from a trip. I told him, I said, no, you don't understand. I found the pearl of great price here, okay? I have to do it now. I have to do it now, tomorrow.
Oh, my gosh.
And then he said, the water is cold. I said, I don't care.
Right.
He said, but there's nobody here. Your family's. I said, listen to me. You're not listening. I don't care about that. I want to do it now.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, he could not persuade me otherwise, because I had found what I was looking for, mm-hmm. You see? So he baptized me on a Wednesday night, that day I wanted. And right there on the baptismal tank, I received the infilling of the Holy Ghost. I spoke in tongues. Well, make a long story short, I was walking on air. Everything I looked at, it was like I was looking through a new glass that had been wiped clean. It was not dirty anymore. The colors had changed. The greens were greener, and the blues were bluer. And everything was beautiful. Everybody I looked at was beautiful. Even the mailman looked beautiful. And I was in love with the Lord, and I just love people.
Mm-hmm.
And I want everyone to be saved. Okay, so at that point, a junction in time, okay? And then, afterwards, of course, I married my wife, who's now my wife, and I began to minister. I began to preach the word right there and then. That same year, I was married, 1982. The Lord called me into the ministry. He didn't even let me enjoy my honeymoon. I began to preach the gospel right there and then, and people began getting saved.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Anyway, that is when he began to really give me dreams and visions about things, the future. And in the last several years, he has been giving me many dreams and visions that have to do with his soon return. Okay? Now, one of the things that I need to also share before I go into some of these dreams and visions, Ari, is, you know, of course, I talked to you, and you mentioned that fact that I pastored, that he called me to pastor church. We started church from nothing, from scratch. Just my wife, sister that came from North Carolina, and myself. That was it. That was the nucleus. And we built it up. The church had a... It must have reached maybe eventually 150 or so. We never were able to grow beyond that because the prices in Miami were exorbitant. For 1 acre, they asked for $1 million back in the 90s.
Wow. Yeah.
No, I'm sorry. Back in the 80s.
Yeah.
In the 80s, they asked for $1 million.
Yeah,
so today you can't imagine. So we never were able to buy a bigger place and expand and grow more. But anyways, in 1992, I had an experience with the Lord one night where he called me to turn in my pastorship, okay, resign as pastor, and leave the church, leave the city of Miami, Florida, Hialeah, leave that whole region and go to a place that he was going to show me. And I did not understand it then, but it was an Abrahamic call.
Huh.
That's what it was.
Yeah.
It was an Abrahamic call, and I didn't understand it then, but for him to do with me what he needed to do and wanted to do, I could not stay there. I had to go where he showed me.
Right.
Now I understand it. I did not understand it back then, so I gave up everything. I gave up my family. I gave up, the church. I gave up, I had given up already my job as an engineer a few years back. Now I gave up the church. I gave up it. You know, my wife had a daycare. We gave that up. And all my friends, we just left everything. I put everything in a moving truck, and we left. And we landed here. This is where I landed, in a little town here in North Florida, close to the Georgia border.
Wow.
Live Oak, and this is where I've been since 1992. Okay. Now, when the Lord gave me that vision that night in Miami, Florida, before I left, this is what he told me, okay? And this is important to what I'm going to share next. But that's why I need to share this. He said to me, I am calling you for an end time ministry.
Oh, wow.
He said, I am calling you to prepare my bride for my soon return. He said, you are going to prepare my people, prepare my bride. He said, you're not the only one that I'm calling.
Mm-hmm.
You are one of many. But he said, it is like a river that has many tributaries, but they all flow in the same river.
Yep.
He said, likewise, it is the same way with all these ministries, and you're one of them. And he said, and I'm going to use you to heal my people, restore them, and help them to become and get ready for my coming. Well, I didn't understand that fully, even back then. The full measure of what that all meant. But I do now. Because years after I came here, and he took years to prepare me, okay, to cleanse me, to purge me of all the leaven. I had learned a lot of stuff that was not of God.
Yeah.
And that is the problem with the church system today. It has a lot of stuff that is not of God.
Mm-hmm.
And it was taught as of God, but it was not. It was man's traditions.
Mm-hmm.
It was man's teachings. It was man's rituals. And the Lord had to strip me of all of that.
Yep.
And cleanse me from all of that. And it took a while. It took a while as he started to peel the onion layers off of me. And as he began to take each layer one by one, I began to see a little more clearly. And a little more clearly. He began to sharpen my discernment, where I began to discern things. Even when people spoke things, I began to discern it. Even the moment they left their mouth, I began to perceive their motives.
Yeah.
I began to perceive their spirit working behind it. I began to perceive whether it was truth or it was lie, or it was truth mixed with lies. All these things began to happen, and he's still working on me on that, but it took a long time. It was a long process, and he began to teach me the scriptures by the Spirit, what they meant. And many of the things that had been taught to me were not from him.
Wow.
So as this was going on, he began to give me dreams and visions that I did not understand, Ari.
Huh.
For example, okay, let me give you one. In 1995, 3 years after I had moved here, I was preaching in a church in Houston, Texas. And when I was preaching there, one night, I have a vision, and I see a UFO in the sky.
Uh-huh.
Now, before I say anything else, let me say this. Back in 1995, I did not believe in UFOs.
Right.
I did not believe in UFOs. I never talked about UFOs. I never read anything about UFOs. As a matter of fact, if anybody would come up to me and talk to me about UFOs, I would just turn them off and walk away, because to me that was nonsense. To me that was ridiculous.
Right.
And to me that was kind of new age, you know, kind of weird stuff out there in the, you know, weird land. So I wanted nothing to do with that. And so I walked away. Now, God knew this. The Lord knows everything. And he knew that he had to break that paradigm in me. Because if he was going to bring me into the place where he wanted to bring me, he needed to break that paradigm and the way I looked at that. So he gave me this dream like that I saw that night, and I began to see this UFO in the sky, and it was the most beautiful thing I've ever seen. It was like a light tree. It was lit up like a light tree, like a Christmas tree. And all beautiful colors, greens, blues, reds, yellows, all kinds. So I went inside the house to tell the people, hey, folks, listen. There's this incredible UFO outside, and it's shining like a Christmas tree. You got to come and see this. And so when I went back outside, Lord and behold, there was not just one UFO, but there was a fleet of UFOs moving in the sky. Now, there was no sound, none. Everything was quiet. But I did see, when I went back outside, I saw the fleet of UFOs, and I saw two military aircraft escorting this fleet of UFO somewhere. And to me, that was very shocking. And I woke up, and I just didn't understand that.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, I didn't believe in UFOs. Secondly, what were those two military aircraft doing escorting this fleet of UFOs
mm-hmm.
somewhere?
Yeah.
So that, to me, I just shut my mouth. I said, Lord, I'm not even going to share this with anybody because they're going to think I'm crazy. They're going to think I'm a lunatic. They're going to think I lost it. So I just didn't share that with a soul. I kept it to myself. Well, the Lord knew what I had done, and he was not about to have any of that. So a year later, I was walking here in my town with my wife, my little girl. Back then, she was, you know, she must have been like 8 or 9 years old. And, you know, we used to walk every evening. So we were walking there where we lived, and it was kind of dusk. It was getting dark. And all of a sudden, my little girl was the first one that spoke up, and she said, "Hey, Dad, look up there. Look up there.
Mm-hmm.
Look at those lights." And I looked up. My wife looked up. And when we looked up, there was these three lights dancing in the skies. Two of the lights were white. One of the lights was yellow-orange type, like, kind of looking lights. And they were dancing around, you know, like in a dogfight. They were like in a dogfight. And they were not airplanes. They were not helicopters. No, they can... Helicopters and planes don't move like that, you know, making sharp turns and fast, lightning-fast, speeds. They don't do that, okay? They don't do that.
Yeah.
And they were not meteors. Meteors don't do that. They don't change direction like that, that quick and move that fast like that.
Right.
So eventually, these three lights, you know, started doing this for a few minutes, and I just stood there with my family watching this thing, you know, like just looking up, not believing what we were watching.
Mm-hmm.
And then the orange, yellowish light just took off.
Mm-hmm.
It just went zoom and left and disappeared, okay? It basically disappeared. And the other two lights went right after it, and zoom, they disappeared after it. Like they went into another dimension because you literally could not see them, move into infinity.
Right.
They just like old fashioned disappeared.
Mm-hmm.
And when that happened, we looked at each other. Okay, I looked at my wife. I looked at my little girl. And we just looked at each other. Their eyes were, just big. You know, like what was that?
Right.
And we didn't know what to say. We just didn't say anything. I just said, "Did you see that?" "Yeah, I saw it." So anyway, we kept going, and we never talked about it again, you know. And this is how I began to realize slowly, bit by bit, the Lord had to awaken me to the reality that these things are real.
Mm-hmm.
There is a real supernatural warfare, spiritual warfare going on in the heavenlies right now, even as I speak, even as we're doing the show. And this has only exponentially exploded in numbers and quantities in the last few years. Nowadays, I look up every night, and almost every night, just about every night or every other night, I can see them.
Mm-hmm.
I can see at least one of them in the skies, and I can spot them. The moment I see them, I can spot them because they are... If you do not know how to discern these things, they may look like a star, but it's not quite. You have to be able to recognize. They may look like a star, but they're not a star. And if you keep watching them, sure enough, they'll change brightness and they will change color. And they will move or may disappear altogether. So these things are increasing and intensifying in numbers as we are getting closer to the manifestation of the Antichrist, the son of perdition, and the appearing of our glorious King, Lord, and Messiah, Lord Jesus Christ, Yahushua HaMashiach. So these things are happening right now, and I don't know if you want me to continue on that and that topic, or you want it.
Well, it's a great topic, and so I'm just curious, and you know, as briefly as you can share this with us. I'm assuming that where you're going with the UFO situation might be that you feel that they're negative beings or entities. Do you feel that there might be some positive off-world creations that are made by our Creator as well?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
I went through a phase, you know, I went through a phase where I had to grow in this knowledge. It didn't all come at once, so I do not expect people that are listening to this show tonight to embrace or understand this, you know, immediately, okay? There is a process, and I went through the process, and I'm basically trying to share in this 2 hours or in this 1 hour what it took me years to understand, mm-hmm. and receive the revelation from the Lord and from what I was learning. So basically, you're getting a condensed version,
right.
And you're getting, if you will, a boot camp training of the things I had to learn, you know, in myself, through periods of time, through years of researching, years of just experientially seeing these things and beginning to understand them, research it, do studies on it, and so forth and so on. At first, I only believed that aliens were all demonic. That's what I believed. I thought they were all demonic, and I had that knowledge for a while. If somebody would ask me, I would say, yeah, they're all demonic. And then as time continued and I began to learn more and more about these things and find scriptures in the Bible, I began to realize that not all these UFOs are demonic, and that some of them are indeed from the Lord. Although most of them are demonic, okay? Most of them are. There sometimes are some that are not. Like, I believe that what I saw that night, like one of them was a fallen angelic, UFO. See, UFO means unidentified flying object, okay? A UFO is not a flying disc like some people think. This was a picture attached to the name UFO that came up after Roswell in 1947, I think, or 48.
Mm-hmm.
People began to identify UFOs as flying discs. Okay, so whenever anyone says a UFO, immediately the image that comes into your mind is a flying disc, you know, like a saucer-shaped disc flying through the air.
Right.
However, that is not what the word UFO means.
Right.
UFO means an unidentified flying object. So that means an object that you see in the heavens, okay? A light, whatever it is, that you cannot identify. You cannot identify it as a plane. You cannot identify it as a helicopter, as a meteor or a comet or anything like that, or as a star. So that is a UFO. So whenever I say UFO, okay, this is what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I wanted just to share that because a lot of people don't realize, what a UFO is.
Yeah.
So I began to see all these UFOs, and I immediately attributed them to demonic activity.
Mm-hmm.
However, I began to do some research, and I began to realize that there indeed are angelic manifestations in heaven.
Right.
And, the Bible talks about warfare, Michael and his angels.
Mm-hmm.
In the book of Daniel, he talks about how Daniel prayed and fasted for 3 weeks, and he did the so-called, quote-unquote, Daniel fast. And after 3 weeks, the angel Gabriel, the archangel Gabriel, came to him with a message and in answer to his prayers.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, the angel told him that he had been detained by the prince of Persia. according to what Gabriel said, a very powerful, mighty fallen angel that was over the region of Medo-Persia, or that region of the Middle East. And so he said that he took Michael, the prince, he said it took him to come to my help, otherwise I could not make it. In other words, the powers of darkness, okay, led by the prince of Persia, okay, the principality and power over that region, had detained even Gabriel, who is a powerful archangel.
Yep.
He could not go through, he could not break through the ranks because of the darkness,
yep,
okay, that covered that region. And so there is extreme spiritual warfare that goes on in the heavens right now. And, you know, whenever we pray, whenever we ask the Lord anything in prayer for an answer, sometimes we don't get the answer right away. And a lot of times has to do with this very thing.
Yeah.
That our answers are delayed because,
yeah,
of demonic activity in the heavenlies, in the spiritual realm. In a country, the more wicked a country is, the more sin there is in the country, the more innocent blood that is shed in a country, the thicker and the bigger the covering of darkness over that region.
Absolutely, and it's really hard to penetrate. So let's segue now with that in mind, with what supposedly are some visions that not only you are having, but many people are having now, specifically with the eastern, northeast part of the United States, with Puerto Rico, with the nuclear weapons that are supposedly in South Carolina. I mean, the United States is going to be really tried here, and so can you share what you know about that?
Well, the thing about this activities going on in FEMA Region 3, this has been going on now for a while, and a lot of people have begun to speculate what that could be, whether it is this or that, and you know, whether it's maybe it's an economic crash, or whether it is some kind of a missile or terrorist attack, whatever. But I always thought that was kind of strange. Why would they be doing this kind of thing? All these MREs, all this food and water, and preparations, you know, and military and personnel and FEMA coffins and all. Why would they be doing this? Something in my spirit just said, you know, something is off here. Something is wrong.
Mm-hmm.
So, I did a lot of praying, a lot of fasting through that. The Lord has been giving me some warnings, okay,
yeah,
which led me to where I am today, and to bring in this the Puerto Rico situation, and I have to share this first, and that is, I have been given some dates that refer to, if you will, to seasons, okay, to periods of time.
Mm-hmm.
Back a few years ago in 2006, the Lord, literally, I had a throne room experience where the Lord gave me, and I'm just trying to, you know, to make this as short as possible for the sake of time,
sure,
where the Lord gave me a period of time when the end of times was going to take place. Okay, we are entering into that time now. Okay, I touched on this on our DVD, The End of Times. I touch on it on our book, The Smile Jesus Loves You, and so forth. So I'm not going to get deep into detail because I want to go quickly into answer your question. But recently, I also had an experience this year where the Lord basically showed me. Okay, I was in a room. There were different people there talking to each other, and we were all talking about the end times. There were two men in particular that were doing calculations on these very strange-looking devices and gadgets that I had never seen before. Okay, they looked very sophisticated. They were not normal normal calculators or computers. If they were computers, they were the smallest computers I've ever seen in my life, but they were powerful. They were just plugging numbers in theirs and just plugging numbers out. And anyway, anyways, they went at it for a while, and after a while, they stopped. And one of them looked at me and said, it's August, from August 2013. And then he stopped and said, till August 2014. And then I woke up. And when I hear that, I said, what was that all about? You know, I said, wait a minute, Lord, I mean, that's not enough. I mean, I didn't get enough information here. What was that? And so the more I prayed, you know, I kept praying, asking the Lord, Lord, please, what is this? What does this have to do with, you know, is this has to do with the economic crash? Does this has to do with a terrorist attack? Does this have to do with what does it have to do with? And you know, I didn't know. And then, and so once I had those dates, and once I had that information, I knew that whatever it was important, and the Lord wanted me to, you know, warn the people. Then I got, I started a Daniel fast during the holidays, the feasts of the Lord, and starting with Rosh Hashanah, mm-hmm. The trumpets.
Right, these are the trumpets.
I began a Daniel fast, a 21-day Daniel fast, and during the fast, I was walking down, up and down the street here where I live, and the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me and said, warn my people.
Hmm.
I said, Lord, I don't understand what you're saying, but warn your people. I am warning your people.
Right.
I am trying to warn the people the best I can, you know, so I don't understand. And then he said again, warn my people. And again, warn my people. Well, you know, I didn't know what he meant. Now he was telling me to warn his people. First he had given me, you know, those dates.
Yeah.
And so I just didn't know what to do with it. You know, I mean, I didn't have enough. So I kept praying, and I just kept researching. And the Lord has a way of just, you know, he brings bits and pieces of information to you. And sometimes I believe that he tries to share with you as much as he can in the time that he can. And I can't explain it all. I don't have all this information, okay? I don't know everything.
Sure.
But I believe that this has a lot to do with spiritual warfare.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that just like in the time of Daniel, I do believe that sometimes, you know, the messengers from the Lord break through and are able to deliver a very quick message, and that is all they can give. Sometimes they have a little more times. I don't know how to explain this to you in detail, but I do believe that is maybe the reason why sometimes we just get little blips, little bits and pieces of information like this, and we don't get the full download.
Yep.
That we should get. And so it has nothing to do with us, that we are faulty or that we are not living right or whatever. It has to do with these other things.
Yep.
That I mentioned to you. And and so, you know, of course, you know, if people are in sin, they're not going to be able to hear the Lord, and the, you know, the enemy puts a blindfold over their ears and over their eyes, mm-hmm. so that you cannot hear and see these things. Okay, yeah. So that can happen too, and then he will block you completely from any connection with the Almighty.
Yep.
But that not being the case, okay, the other reasoning applies, I think, as well. So then I began to research and find out that about very strange things going on in Puerto Rico, which mm-hmm. You know, had it began appearing in different articles about FEMA coffins,
yeah.
And you know, body bags being seen, mm-hmm. in the Puerto Rico, arriving in Puerto Rico in large numbers. I even saw a report by Telemundo from a TV station in Puerto Rico,
yep.
talking about this.
Yeah, I saw it too.
And so I confirmed that from many people that wrote me emails and told me, he said, Brother Augusto, my mom lives there, my family lives there, blah, blah, blah. I can confirm this thing. This is true. Wow. They are seeing this thing. They are hearing it. It is being, they're listening to it in the TV and through the radio and the news. These things are going on. FEMA is there. NASA people are there. The troops are there. There are military vehicles there, and so forth and so on. So I managed to confirm these things that are, they were in fact happening in Puerto Rico. So when these things, when I began to hear these things, my heart began to get the feeling that this, I was heading in the right direction, that this had everything to do with what the Lord was trying to show me. Mm-hmm. So then I find out about a prophet there in Puerto Rico. His name is Efraín Rodríguez, who had a word from the Lord back in 2010, okay, where the Lord told him that there was an asteroid going to fall there near Puerto Rico, near the island of La Mona, and which is between Puerto Rico and the Dominican Republic. And it was going to be such an impact that it was going to cause an earthquake around 12.0 Richter scale. And it was going to literally cause a tsunami about 1,000 feet high that was going to hit not only Puerto Rico and Dominican Republic, but Cuba, Central America, the Gulf, and even the eastern coast of the United States. He said, and I tried to contact the man. I did contact him. He sent me information, all his information, and he basically says that he spoke with NASA personnel, scientists that were there, and other scientists, and they have confirmed that this, in fact, is something that they are afraid that may happen. And there is a trench there in northern Puerto Rico, a fault line, a trench, that they are afraid may be triggered by this impact. It's going to cause severe, massive tsunamis, and maybe it trigger other earthquakes in other parts of the world. And they're expecting, according to him, he spoke to these people, they're expecting the death toll to be in excess of 750,000 people. They're important, just in Puerto Rico.
Wow.
And they said that the death toll in all these regions I mentioned could reach 26 million.
Wow.
And he said that the people from FEMA and NASA are very afraid. They are really very concerned about this, and they're afraid. Now, he was given, of course, the sign that when Gigi Avila, the evangelist Gigi Avila, passed away, that this would be, when this event would happen. Now, he was told this in 2010. Now, for people that don't know, Gigi Avila passed away in June 28 of this year. So he was told by the Lord that whenever this happens, whenever this man dies, know that this event is about to happen. So, anyways, I listen to a lot of people. A lot of people sent me stuff, sent me dreams and visions. But when I heard this brother, I knew in my heart that this was a message from the Lord. And, a lot of people, there's a lot of people out there that talk, and those people will always be there. But I don't go by what people say. I don't go by what people say. I stopped doing that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I listen to the Lord. Mm-hmm. Okay, and I go by what I feel in my spirit and what the Spirit of God leads me to. And when I heard this brother sharing this, it bore witness in my spirit that this was from God.
Yep.
And this was something that the Lord had shown me in other visions and dreams, because I have seen this event, although I have not seen the asteroid hit.
Yeah.
That spot, I didn't see that. The Lord did not show me that specific thing.
Yeah.
But he did show me the effects of this thing. And he, for example, he showed me some years ago, and this is all posted on our website under Dreams and Visions. I have had several dreams of tsunamis hit the U.S. East Coast.
Mm-hmm.
I saw one, for example, where all the way from the coast of Maine, the state of Maine, all the way down to Miami, Florida, and the Keys, it was all covered in water, inland about going about 20 to 25 miles inland. I saw it all underwater. I have had another visions and dreams where I saw the southern third of Florida totally gone underwater. That would be up to north of Okeechobee, okay? Mm-hmm. North of Okeechobee, somewhere around there, north of Okeechobee, all that region south of that was gone. It was all gone. And he has shown me many, many things like that. I have had other dreams where where the Lord took me mm-hmm. to the city of Miami, Florida. Mm-hmm. And he showed me there, all that region there in South Florida, it was all flooded. It was all covered in water. And so I had seen this, and I knew that this was going to happen.
Yeah.
And I have seen asteroids falling. Okay, I have seen fireballs mm-hmm. falling from heaven. He gave me this vision in the night one time a few years back. So I know these things were going to happen, and I knew those asteroids were going to fall. So I started putting those things together, and what God showed this man was basically, you know, that those asteroids the Lord showed me hitting right there, and that is what would cause the tsunamis and all these areas that I saw. It was all gone, covered in water, which would probably cause that.
Let me ask you a quick question, just interjection. I have actually two different questions, but number one, do you think that it's a possibility that it's some of the debris from ISON? Do you think ISON is part of the equation here?
Well, ISON could be part of the equation because ISON is a comet that is coming, you know, it's a sun grazer. It's going to be coming very close to the Earth and the sun. And he has such a huge tail of debris that is dragging. Because what a lot of people do not understand is that when these comets come in, okay, they come through the asteroid belt. And whenever they go through the asteroid belt, they pick up a lot of this junk. And if you could look at the asteroid belt, if you could look at it, you know, from outer space, if you could look at our solar system and the asteroid belt, is an area, okay, between Mars and Jupiter that is loaded with junk, which is from another planet that used to be there that somehow was shattered and exploded, okay, many, a long time ago. This became known as the asteroid belt, okay? That area where the asteroid belt is, that is where this planet used to be. That was its orbit, okay? And it's no longer there. All we have now is called the asteroid belt. Now, these comets that come in, they're going to pass through there. They have to pass through the asteroid belt to get to our inner solar system. So when they come into our inner solar system, they're going to drag a lot of that junk, and some of it they're going to push it ahead of it. This is why we have been seeing all these meteors and asteroids, you know, crashing all over the place. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, having said that, what is causing all these meteors and comets to be, you know, to come our way? Something is hurling them
yeah.
our way. Something mm-hmm. is causing this,
mm-hmm.
and this is not happening by itself.
Right.
And so there must be an object out there somewhere. It's getting closer
mm-hmm.
to us. It comes, I believe, and others believe as well, that this is the object spoken of in the Bible as the destroyer. And this is the same object that caused all the havoc back during the Exodus, all the plagues, which are very eerily similar to the plagues spoken of in the book of Revelations.
Yep.
And I believe this could have been the same kind of thing that caused the destruction of, that took place in the days of Noah,
yep.
in the flood,
mm-hmm.
and Atlantis was destroyed.
Mm-hmm.
I believe this was the same object, and this object, which is basically, it has an elliptic orbit around our solar system, okay, around our sun and around another sun, which is about 3,600. You know, it takes about 1,800 years to go from there to here, from there to there, making it 3,600 years plus or minus.
Right.
Another sun, which is called the Black Sun, or the Brown Dwarf,
right,
or our twin star.
Yep.
Which is out there somewhere. Okay, so this object, which many have dubbed the Planet X, the Destroyer, some people call it Nibiru, but I don't like to use that name because that is associated, you know, with fiction and fictional, novels written by Zachariah Sitchin.
Mm-hmm.
So I like to stick with a name that the Lord calls it. The Lord calls it the Destroyer. And there's another name in the Bible called Wormwood.
Mm-hmm.
So I rather call it by that name, the Destroyer and Wormwood. And so whenever it comes by and it comes close, it begins to hurl, okay? It begins to drag all kinds of comets and cometoids from the Orion, area and from the Oort clouds there in the Orion, and it begins to hurl them towards us in the inner solar system here on our solar system. And this is why we have been seeing such an enormous amount of comets,
mm-hmm,
in recent years. And comets that we've never seen before, because, you know, there are comets that we see every now and then, like Halley's Comet.
Yeah.
But all these comets we have been having lately, they have never come our way, ever, never.
Yeah.
And so why now? Why so many? So the reason is something is throwing it at us.
Mm-hmm.
And so whenever these comets are thrown at us by this object, they come loaded with junk. Okay? And this is why all these asteroids are hitting us. The other thing about this that makes it dangerous is that, and again, you mentioned ison. Ison could be what's causing all these asteroids to be hitting us now. But the bottom line is this, and I don't want people to focus on ison, although ison could be dangerous. And ison is supposed to be passing close to us November, December, okay? And it just happens to be the time when all these people are preparing their GridX exercises and,
yep,
their FEMA exercises and all these exercises. We're supposed to have ended all the preparations by October 1st, and the GridX is supposed to be taking place November 13 and 14,
mm-hmm,
which is an exercise on the grid, our power grid, going down. Now, why are they doing that, you see?
Yeah.
That don't make sense unless they're expecting something to bring the power grid down.
Mm-hmm.
And so this coincides with the passing of ison, okay? Now, whether ison is the one that's going to cause all this or not, I don't know.
Right.
But it could cause it. It could be the cause of this, many of these asteroids. But, you know, so as people, as not cause the people to focus overly on ison, whether it's ison or it's something else, there are going to be many other comets coming our way.
Yeah.
And many other asteroids being thrown at us. So, you know, because from my experience, Ari, is if you tell people ison, you know, ison, they look at ison.
Yeah.
And when ison comes and goes and nothing happens, they relax again. See, that was all a bunch of baloney.
Right, that's right.
So I don't want people to just focus on ison. I want people to see ison as another evidence that something is wrong. Because it's not just ison. Okay? Look at the volcanoes. Look at the earthquakes.
Mm-hmm.
Today there was another huge earthquake. It seems like every day there is a 6.0 earthquake or higher.
Yep.
Taking place around us.
Mm-hmm.
And what is causing this? You see, what is causing this? This is not normal.
No.
And this is exactly what the Lord Almighty said that was going to happen, as in the days of Noah. You know, he said, as it was in the days of Noah, as it was in the days of Sodom and Gomorrah. And so people need to understand where this is coming from.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there are many things fixing to happen as this object gets closer to us. All of these things are going to increase and intensify.
And
I believe
And is this object a planet, or is it part? Is it the actual dwarf star, or the brown dwarf, or is it a planetoid of that star, or do you know?
Yeah, the destroyer is a planet. Okay. That some people say is inhabited by these creatures, by these they call them the people like Zachariah Sitchin, and maybe some in the New Age call it the Anunnaki.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. In the Bible, the name used is also, the Nephilims. They're called the Geborim. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And so the Bible mentions these creatures as well. As a matter of fact, there are scriptures in the Bible that talk about this thing, like, for example, the book of Isaiah. The book of Isaiah, chapter 13, it talks about this very thing. If I may read that, it's very interesting because it explains it very, 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 very clearly.
Yes, please.
In Isaiah, chapter 13, verse 3, okay, it says, I'm reading from the Septuagint, which is the original text, okay?
Okay.
He says, I give a command, and I bring them. Giants are coming to fulfill my wrath, rejoicing at the same time and insulting. A voice of many nations on the mountains, even like that of many nations, a voice of kings and nations gathered together. The Lord of hosts has given command to a warlike nation to come from a land far off. Now listen to this. From the utmost foundation of heaven, the Lord and his warriors are coming to destroy all the world. Howl ye, for the day of the Lord is near, and destruction from God shall arrive. Therefore every hand shall become powerless, and every soul of men shall be dismayed. Okay? The elders shall be troubled, and pangs shall seize them as a woman in travail, and they shall mourn one to another, shall be amazed, and shall change their countenance as a flame. For behold, the day of the Lord. Now here you see again that I mentioned the day of the Lord. I'm gonna share that about that in just a moment, because the day of the Lord is intricately connected with this event. This is the day of the Lord. This is the day of God's wrath. And to destroy sinners out of it, okay? To destroy sinners, not the righteous, not those that belong to the Lord, to destroy the sinners out of it, okay? Verse 10, for the stars of heaven. Now, that word stars in the original text is, it has to do with asteroid, okay?
Huh.
That's where the word asteroid comes from astari. And that's, that is the word they use there. The stars of heaven, the asteroids, okay, the meteors and the comets, and Orion, okay, now he mentions Orion in the Septuagint, and many of these occultic circles and the New Age circles, they mentioned that these entities are coming from Orion.
Huh.
Yeah. And some of them have even mentioned that they have, in their uniforms or whatever they wear, the constellation, a sign of the constellation Orion. Now, that's all I'm going to say about that, because I don't want to get into that stuff, because that's not my forte.
Right.
But I'm just telling you, these entities are coming from Orion. The Bible tells you they're coming from Orion. Okay? So that is not New Age. That is the Bible telling you they're coming from Orion. And all the host of heaven and shall not give their light. And it shall be dark at sunrise. And the moon shall not give her light. And I will command evils for the whole world, and will visit their sins on the ungodly. Again, there's the word. On the ungodly. Not on the righteous. Not on those that belong to the Lord Almighty. Not to those that are saved and are followed Jesus Christ the Lamb, to the ungodly. And I will destroy the pride of transgressors, and I will bring low the pride of the haughty. And they that are left shall be more precious than gold tried in the fire, and a man shall be more precious than the stone that is in sulfur. For the heavens shall be enraged, and the earth shall be shaken from her foundation. Now, notice that. The earth shall be shaken from her foundation. Because because of the fierce anger of the Lord of hosts in the day in which his wrath shall come. Now, having read that, I want to share that another thing that the Lord showed this brother from Puerto Rico was that when this object hit, it was going to cause the rotation of the earth to stop.
Wow.
The rotation of the earth was going to stop. And I believe, if I'm not mistaken, that he said it was going to stop for about 3 days. Now, I think that's a long time.
Yeah.
But I think it's going to be less than that. But anyways, you know, that's neither here or there. He said that the Lord showed him it was going to be 3 days. Now, the earth is going to, something, when this thing impacts the earth, it's going to be so powerful that it's going to cause the rotation of the earth, you know, to cease. The earth is going to, it's going to wobble. This is in the scriptures. This is recorded in the scriptures, okay?
Yeah.
This was prophesied by prophet Isaiah and in many other scriptures. This is basically what begins the day of the Lord. This initiates the wrath of God on the planet. I believe with all of my heart that the day of the Lord shall begin on planet Earth with a meteor strike. That is what's going to cause the huge earthquake spoken of in the book of Revelation, chapter 6. If you read that carefully, if we can go there real quick and read in Revelation, chapter 6, it says there that, you know, and this is what happens right before the wrath of the Lamb begins. Okay, this begins the wrath of the Lamb.
Mm-hmm.
It says, when he opened the sixth seal in Revelation 6:12, there was a great earthquake. Okay, now this is not just a normal earthquake. This is not going to be a 7, a 8, or even a 9.0 a Richter scale. Remember the one that hit Chile?
Yeah.
It moved the shoreline several feet.
Mm-hmm.
And it shortened the day by fractions of a minute. Okay? And the one that hit Fukushima, Japan, it did the same thing. It moved the shoreline and it changed time, affected time.
Mm-hmm.
Now, those two were around 9 Richter scale. According to this, what this brother was shown, and according to this scripture, this one is going to be much worse. It's going to be like a 10 or 11 or 12 on the Richter.
Wow.
And it's going to, he calls it a great earthquake. Okay? And said the sun became black as sackcloth. The moon became as blood. Okay? The stars of heaven, again, that word stars there is the word where we get our asteroid, the word asteroid.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Asteroids fell from heaven, basically, if we want to replace that word with asteroid. And the asteroids of heaven fell onto the earth, even as a fig tree casts its unripe figs when it is shaken by a mighty wind.
Right.
That's how many are going to fall.
Jeez.
And the heavens departed as a scroll when it's rolled together. And every mountain and island were moved out of their places. Okay? Well, we already know what a 9.0 earthquake did.
Mm-hmm.
To Chile, and this, and there in that area, he moved the island. He moved the shores several feet. So it's not far-fetched when we read here that every mountain and island were moved out of their places. That's what they're that's what they're talking about here.
Yeah,
they're going to be moved. Okay,
yeah.
Out of their places, and so right there now. See, if I would have read that, say 20, 30 years ago, it wouldn't probably have made much sense to me.
Mm-hmm.
But now it makes all the sense in the world, because we've already seen a small version of this.
Yep. It's all relative. And if the Earth were to stop rotating, assuming that if that does ever happen, I mean, imagine what it does to the water. It will just come out of the basins of the ocean, wouldn't it?
Oh, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
It would, you know, there would be a wash,
yep.
You know, the waves going back and forth, and you know, anyone that is living right on the coast, I would dare say You know, some people say 300 miles off the coast. Well, maybe. From what I've seen, it was like 25 miles off the coast. The water came in Florida.
Wow.
And all the East Coast, I saw it come in about 25 miles. And if you do the calculations and proportions to what happened in Fukushima,
mm-hmm.
you know, that earthquake there, it produced a tsunami about 90, you know, about close to 100 feet high.
Right.
And it went in about 9-10 miles. So a tsunami that when it reaches the shoreline is a couple of hundred feet, which is by what the Lord showed, you know, the prophet, you know, Ephraim Rodriguez. By the time it reaches the shores in the eastern, you know, the United States and Central America, it's going to be about 200 miles high. That would go in 25 miles, like I was shown.
200 miles high or 200 feet high?
No, 200 feet high.
200 feet high, okay.
200 feet high. Yeah, 200 feet high. No, it's 200 feet high.
Okay.
When he first hits, he said it was going to be, you know, the tsunami produced was going to be 1,000 feet.
Oh, wow.
But as it travels, it loses the energy. And by the time it hits, you know, some other parts of the U.S. coast, it's going to be, according to what he said, what he saw, what he was told, a couple hundred feet, which is still great. It's still a tremendous tsunami if we compare it to Fukushima.
Yeah.
So what I'm trying to say is, if people live close to the coasts, they need to get out. And unless the Lord specifically tells you to stay.
Yep.
I'm going to say that, in times past, I may have said, don't move unless the Lord tells you to move. But I am going to change that and say, stay. I say, do not stay unless the Lord tells you to stay.
Yeah.
If the Lord doesn't tell you to stay, you need to get out.
Yeah. Well, there's plenty of warning, you know, being given out via people like yourself and other people for this, you know, there's plenty of warning. And so those that decide to stay is because, as indeed, like you said, they're being told otherwise. That's crazy. Now, and I'm assuming that if a meteor were to fall in that area, as Efrain Rodriguez has said, that more than likely there might be other chunks of rocks and whatnot falling in other places. I'm assuming,
right.
Yeah, that it's not going to be just isolated to that area. I'm guessing.
Right. Yeah, it's going to be falling in many places simultaneously, mm-hmm. and you know, in like in progressive form.
Yeah.
You know, it's going to. And again, I'm not a physicist or an astrophysicist, astronomer, or you know, scientist, to be able to give you a better explanation. So I'm going to do the best I can. But you know, as the Earth rotates, you know, the Earth rotates, you know, in a certain way, and as these things are coming in, okay, whatever area the you know it begins to hit the Earth, just assume that as the Earth continues to rotate.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to continue to see these objects begin to pound.
Oh, yeah.
That region that is coming into view or is coming into contact with that beating that you know and the pounding that is taken from this asteroid. So just figure it like a machine gun, you know, just machine gun fire coming in, and the Earth continues to rotate. That is, I think, that's probably how it's going to be.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. What do you feel that the East Coast preparation with the FEMA and the whole thing that's going on up there, do you think it's more because it's a man-made situation, a possible tsunami, perhaps a missile that might be, or a false flag, or do you think it's also part of this event that we're speaking about, the meteorites?
I think the whole deal there is the continuity of government.
Okay.
You know, that's basically it. It makes sure that continuity of government, you know, is there, and they're going to protect that above all things.
Mm-hmm.
They protect. protection and the survival of the people, that comes in, lower down in the list of priorities as far as this government is concerned. It's sad, but that's the truth. Some other governments in other parts of the world take more care of the people, much, much better care of the people. Even, for example, Russia has built underground bunkers and in their subways, they have made sure that they have enough capacity there to where the people can go and hide there in case of an emergency. The same with China. China has many of these cities also and underground subways where they have built many of them for them, to house the people. And then in other places throughout Europe, in some of the Scandinavian countries. But here in the U.S., we haven't seen that happen, unfortunately. I think the only thing they have done is buy large amounts of food and, water and things like that, like mm-hmm. MREs, mm-hmm. to, be able to feed some of the survivors. And I believe this is what's going to be happening in the FEMA camps.
Yeah.
FEMA camps are probably have been set up for that purpose, to house a lot of the people that are going to be survivors from the cities and the areas that are devastated during these things when they begin to happen. And these areas are those areas, that are going to have food and water,
mm-hmm.
and I guess a dry, safe place where people can live and go and stay.
Sure.
So people are going to be very tempted to accept that.
Yeah.
Because they won't have any food,
yep.
water, or a place to stay. And a lot of people talk about, FEMA camps, but if you find yourself without food and water and a place to live, and you got family, you got especially kids, they're probably going to take that offer without thinking twice.
I know. So the purpose of all this information, okay, that we're, the visions and the right now the ministry that you have in trying to warn the people, because a lot of people, of course, hear this information and they'll say, "Oh, he's fear mongering. It's fear based. It's all this." And I get this all the time, okay? As many of us that also bring this information forth get this as well. So how do you contest that? Is it about fear?
No, of course not.
Okay.
Of course not. Do you see my voice?
At all.
Hype, yeah. any notion that I'm trying to intimidate people,
mm-hmm.
that I'm trying to, to hype people up, to arouse their emotions? No. I'm talking calm. I'm sharing these things mm-hmm. with the people, trying to help them. I'm not pushing any food,
mm-hmm.
any gold or silver.
Right.
Not pushing any product.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not doing any of that because I don't have an agenda.
Mm-hmm.
There is no agenda here that I'm, I'm pushing. So my only reason for sharing this is to warn the people. And so this is not about fear-mongering. This is about preparing the people. Ignorant people, okay? People that are just ignorant, they call it fear-mongering or fear-hungering or whatever they want to call it. But to those that know better, they hear this and they realize it is a warning to prepare. If people are not warned, Ari, when these things happen, okay, they are going to come face to face with a crisis. And this crisis is unlike any crisis they have ever faced before. This is going to change the way they live overnight. People are not comfortable with change, period. This event is going to change their lives 180 degrees in a way they have never seen ever before. And so people that are warned, if someone hears this message and they are warned and they receive it and they prepare, first of all, spiritually, they prepare where they accept Jesus Christ, the offer he gives, which is an unconditional offer of love and to come to him and he will save you. Because even if people die, okay, the worst case scenario is that people will die, no matter what, they're going to die. Some people are at ground zero, and there's no escaping it. Okay, so let's say that is the case. Are you ready to die? If you were to die today, are you prepared? Do you have the, I mean, is your life right with God?
Mm-hmm.
Have you put your house in order,
mm-hmm,
with God? You see, so this is not just about fear mongering. This is about preparation. First, spiritual preparation, so that you are safe, so that in case you die, you know where you're going to spend eternity. You're not going to spend it in a in a dark dungeon, okay? Away, separated from your loving Father, God the Creator.
Mm.
You're going to be in His presence. In the moment you die, instantly, you're going to be in His presence. So that's number one. In case you die, you need to have the preparation done for that. Then secondly, you need to have the preparation done if you want to make it through this. Some people don't want to make it through this. I mean, some people just don't care. They don't want to make it through this.
Yeah, I know.
And that's fine.
Yep.
But if you don't want to make it through this, are you ready for the next life? Are you ready for what comes after this one?
Right.
So that is very important. That's a decision you need to make, and you need to make it this day when you, as you heard this program. And so, but those that want to make it through, those that want to, you know, fight to live another day, you need to make some preparations. You need to get away from the shorelines, from the shores, because the seas are going to come in. And you need to make some physical preparations and put away some food and put away some water and get some filters so that the water that you can find, you can at least make it drinkable.
Yeah.
Because water is going to become a matter of life and death.
Yeah, I totally.
And so these are things that you can do now relatively easy if you take time to prepare. Okay? If you take time to do it, you can, these things are not that hard to get. They're not that expensive. I mean, people can live on rice and beans for a long time and clean water, okay?
Mm-hmm.
It may not be the best food, but you can live on that. Anyone can live on that. And so these things can be gotten at a very, very, very cheaply.
Yeah.
Instead of spending or wasting, squandering your money on stuff that you ain't going to need. And it's probably all going to go, you know where.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, you know, this is something that nobody wants to hear this.
Nope.
But this is something that is going to help you. And if you have families, you know, just get close to them, love them, and make peace with them. Get your heart clean out. Get your heart free from bitterness,
mm-hmm,
and resentment and unforgiveness. And get away from all this junk, okay, of the occult and voodoo and all these ungodly things that Hollywood is pushing.
That's right.
Please, now with Halloween coming up,
yep,
the ungodly flow is it's ungodly, so horrible coming from Hollywood. All this gore and all these ungodly things. Stay away from that junk. That will pollute your soul.
Absolutely.
And it will bring fear.
Yep.
The same people that accuse us of fear mongering are the very ones that go to listen and watch fearful things like that.
Yeah.
Why would anybody pay money to see people whose limbs are cut off and heads cut off and blood all over the place and you know and
yeah,
all kind? Why would anybody pay money for that?
Yeah.
See, that is fearful. That puts fear in your heart.
Yeah.
Why? So. You know, no. I think it's totally unbased to accuse me or you or anyone else of fear mongering.
I agree. So the time frames that we're looking at so far, from what I understood you say, is around, you said August 20 of 2013 to about August 20 of 2014. Is that correct? More or less the timeline.
That is what I was shown.
Okay.
Now that doesn't mean that everything's going to happen then.
Right.
From what I was shown. And according to what I've been seeing now is that some major event is going to happen in this timeline.
Okay.
That is going to change the way that we live, the world as we know it, because that's what I was told. The world as you know it is going to cease to exist.
Yep.
So I'm not saying it's the second coming of Jesus Christ. I'm not saying it's the end of the world. I'm not not saying any of that. I'm just saying that there's going to be an event that is going to happen that may change our world the way we know it. And from all these preparations going on, that is very possible. Now, having said that, there may be even worse things that are coming down the pike, even beyond that.
Wow.
Okay, because this object that is coming, I believe it's going to be coming within the next few years. Not within 10 or 20 or 30 years, it's going to be coming within the next few years. We don't have time to get into all these other things. We're going to have two tread threats in 2014 and 2015. Those are major symbolic signs in the heavens, okay, that fall on feasts, on the feasts of the Lord. And this, I mean, this is rare. It's not going to happen again in our lifetimes. So, you know, all these signs are happening. All these signs are going on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Israel is going to be having its jubilee in 2017. There's a prophecy written by a man, you know, a Jewish rabbi, that talks about, you know, the 50th jubilee of Israel.
Wow.
And you know, when that happened, when the 50th jubilee of Israel took place,
mm-hmm.
he said that would be the the beginning of the Messianic age.
Yeah.
The name of this rabbi is Rabbi Judah Ben Samuel.
Hmm.
Made this prediction in 1517.
Wow. Well, we'll definitely have to be...
Yeah, that there will be 10 jubilees until the beginning of the Messianic age. Well, you do the calculations, and that brings us to 2017.
Wow.
So...
Well, we definitely have to keep our eyes open, for sure. And we're definitely out of time. I would love to go into that a little bit more with you, and I'm hoping that you accept my invitation to be back on our show, because we've just not even scratched the tip of the iceberg here. But I would love to have you again. Your website is theappearance.com. Is that correct, Augusto?
That's right.
Fantastic. And Augusto, thank you very much for being with us tonight. You've totally have gone into so much, in depth into your Christian faith, your path, your walk, and where it's led you up to basically today with all your vision and your current ministry. That it's absolutely fantastic to me, and I'm always open to hearing all different kinds of information coming from everywhere, regardless of whether somebody is of the Christian faith or not. I think that the information you bring forth resonates with everyone. So again, thank you very much for sharing that with us and spending time with us tonight. You have all been listening to Shattering the Matrix. My name is Ari Kopel, and you've been listening to Augusto, Augusto Perez, who of course has been so kind and gracious to be with us tonight. You can catch us next week at 6 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, every Saturday night, and I'm looking forward to catching you next week. Thank you very much, and good night.
You've been listening to Shattering the Matrix with your host, Ari Kopel. Please visit our website, 2012emergence.com. That's 2012emergence.com. Find us on Twitter at Matrix Shattered, and like us on Facebook at facebook.com/shatteringthematrix. Listen to archived shows at blogtalkradio.com/shatteringthematrix. And join us next time for the birth of the new golden era on Shattering the Matrix.